morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. Today's webinar is part of our University Recruiting Essentials series, and it's about building brand recognition with scholarships. So we have a good number of guests today. Again, thank you very much. Good morning to many of you. Good afternoon to many of you. We have people from both coasts in the middle represented here, so good group so far. So before we get started, a couple of items just with the mechanics of the webinar. So first off, we already did an audio check. If you have any issues with audio or cannot hear us well enough, let us know. So you're muted right now, and the best way to get your questions or comments across is through the GoToWebinar control panel. You have a chat box, so feel free to type in any questions or comments that you have or feedback during the presentation. So again, you're all muted, but you can definitely type in questions at any point during the presentation. If relevant to the point at hand, we can stop and answer the question. Otherwise, we're going to wait until the end and address all your questions. So definitely type them in and get familiar with the panel on the right side of your screen. My name's Roberto Angulo, and I'm the CEO and co-founder of After College. I started After College as a student when I was at Stanford studying economics. And with me this morning, I also have Matthew Baum, who's our Director of Talent Solutions.
Yeah, good morning, everybody. Like Roberto said, my name's Matt. I've been at After College for about 2 years. I actually started in the online recruitment world a little over a decade ago now. I was at Yahoo back when they still had a hotjobs.com. And for about 4 years, after I left Hot Jobs for about 4 years, I was in charge of the teams that handled small and medium-sized customers, as well as job board customers at simplyhired.com. I also managed job board relationships for a company called Work4 that focuses on social media recruitment solutions. So I've been around the space for a while, and like I said, I've been here at After College for about 2 years, Roberto and I are going to be presenting today's webinar in tandem. Once again, thank you everybody for joining us.
Thank you, Matt. So for those of you who are not familiar with After College, I'll just tell you a little bit about who we are. After College is the largest career network for college students and recent graduates. And our mission is to help students find their first job or internship. And for employers, our goal is to help companies target the right students from the right disciplines at the right campuses. We work with roughly 18,000 faculty and administrative contacts at over 2,300 universities. In a given year, we have 5 million students and recent graduates using After College. And also at any given point, we have over 25,000 employers using After College in one way or another. And the reason, and this is just to give an idea of the sort of the ecosystem we work in and who we work with, just to give you an idea of where our knowledge base is coming from. As I mentioned, I started After College with a group of other students when we were at Stanford. And the main motivation for starting After College was a personal one. So, I was a student majoring in economics, had no idea what I wanted to do. I definitely knew that I didn't want to wear a suit when I graduated, and I didn't know how to program in Java. So that gave us the idea of starting After College to help students like myself and just students in general discover opportunities or companies that they just weren't aware of. And if you fast forward to today, this whole issue of what do I want to do when I graduate and where do I want to go is still pretty relevant among students. So,
and I just want to jump in real quickly and say, I have the same story that most of my employees do, which is, I wish I had known about After College when I graduated. I was a computer science major turned rhetoric major. Not a very clear career path for rhetoric majors from the University of California, Berkeley. Wasn't exactly sure what I wanted to do. Didn't discover that careers in sales and marketing are really a great fit for liberal arts majors for 3 or 4 years after I left school. So My team, is comprised of all of our sales and marketing people. Our team is comprised of a lot of folks with similar stories, literature majors, theater majors, folks who didn't know what they wanted to do with their career. And after college is just a really exciting place to be because we help solve that problem in a really meaningful and novel way. And that, not as just a shameless plug, that's really I want you guys to understand where we're coming from and what puts us in a position to talk to you about scholarships specifically. We've been running our own scholarship programs for years, and that's part of why we're in a great position to talk to you about how to utilize them as a branding tool and why we have all the knowledge that we do have over the last 15 years.
So enough about after college. This is about you and how you can leverage scholarships in your college recruiting efforts. So we've worked with a number of companies over the years who've had scholarships, and they've done them for altruistic reasons, but also it's helped them with their college recruiting initiatives. And what we're learning is that as we talk to companies, large and small, and an example of such companies are organizations like CH2M Hill, GEICO, KPMG, Northrop Grumman, these are some employers that are leveraging scholarships to get their name out on campus while also helping students get a good education. Over the years, we've given away over $1 million for scholarships and student activities. So we know these work. Students like scholarships, so do professors and other audiences on campus. So we're pretty excited to just share at a high level how these scholarships have worked and how they can work for you, and then also just getting very tactical and very practical on things you can do to get your scholarship program in gear or make it better if you already have one. So with that, I'll hand it over to Matt, and we're going to spend the next few minutes just explaining how you can leverage these scholarship opportunities to get your brand across.
Thanks, Roberto. I think scholarships as a branding tool is really the focus of our discussion here, but I think it's really important to understand that scholarships are really, as I like to say, it's just one piece of a healthy breakfast. It's part of a comprehensive university recruiting strategy. Those that do it best, they engage students really early, and they work to build their employment brand in the mind of those students. And so I think we have to be clear with our definitions. Employment brand is very different from consumer brand because it encompasses not just name and logo and what you do as a business, but it also encompasses what working for your company means. What's the career path? What are the benefits? What's the workplace culture? Those are all parts of your employment brand. So, again, those that do it best, those who really implant a concept of their employment brand in the minds of the potential future workforce, they focus on diversity. They have a clear strategy that defines their goals, and they know how they're going to measure their return on investment. And again, they start early. So, it's often said people were only going to remember two or three of the things that they learned during a presentation. If you don't remember anything else from our presentation here, this is the one thing I want you to take away from this webinar. And don't worry, we're going to remind you. Scholarships are about your brand. They're about attracting top students, making a hire, maybe one of the results of these efforts, but it's not the primary goal of your scholarship program. The goal is to be recognized as an employer of choice and be perceived as a great place for students to start their careers. If you achieve that goal, everything else falls into place. You will make the hires. You will get the interns. You will build that solid workforce for the future. But you can't think of it in terms of, I need to make the hire. I need to use a scholarship to make a hire. I need to use a scholarship to fill a job. You need to think of it in terms of the scholarship is how we establish our brand as part of the mindset. And once that brand is established, like I said, everything else falls into place. So what should be the goals of your scholarship program? So throughout all the interviews we've done with different employers, one of the things that we found to be really important was building a stronger relationship with their community, or a variety of communities even. It's one of the key objectives, one of the key observed results of running a scholarship program. So it might be your local community, if you're a local employer, it might be a global community. It might be just a community of people within a certain profession, a community of people with a certain skill set, like a guild. Humanizing your brand and connecting with the community is one of the best reasons to have an ongoing scholarship program. It makes you feel less like a sort of a corporate monolith and adds a little humanity to what you do as a business. Really kind of piggybacking on that, dovetailing nicely with that same concept is social consciousness. This is a really big facet of an employment brand. You want to gain visibility for the social consciousness that is it's so important to your company. If you've read any reports on Generation X, Generation Y, Millennials, and kind of the personality profiles of the last few generations, you know each generation cares progressively more about their employer's social consciousness. They want to work for a company that's making a positive impact. They don't want to work for a company that's doing harm. It's the old Google do no evil sort of mentality. So scholarship programs provide a really good way to show a potential new college grad talent, that your company has a culture of social responsibility. They care about giving back to our society. It's a really valuable opportunity to talk about charitable giving and other philanthropic programs your company might run. So whether your consumer brand lends itself to social consciousness or not, you know, you don't have to be a recycling company. You don't have to be Earth First. You know, you can be any type of company, but a scholarship program provides a really great opportunity to kind of communicate your commitment to your social consciousness and communicate that to your future workforce. So I talked about the healthy breakfast and kind of the role of scholarships within university recruiting. I like to think of it as a tool in your toolbox. So a lot of the names, again, that I saw registered here, I think some of you have whole teams working alongside you or with you. For college recruiting specifically. If you have a university recruiting team, or even if you just have recruiters or hiring managers who are tasked with university recruiting, you've probably given them a toolkit of resources. Maybe it's budget to go and fly and go to a career fair. Maybe it's access to a job posting resource. Maybe it's access to a resume database. Maybe it's access to a career services network or to NaceLink, tools like that. Think of scholarships as another tool within that toolkit. We talked a lot about it already as that high-level part of your brand strategy. That it's part of that bigger, broader approach. Now let's talk about it on a small, tactical level. In contrast, think about the fact that your recruiters really need to be aware of your scholarships. They need to receive a lot of information and training on how to use those scholarships as a tool. So the onus is on you as the organizer of the scholarship to provide internal education to your teammates, your subordinates, even your leaders, in order to make sure that your entire team is aware of the scholarships available. So again, your team has to be aware. They have to know that the scholarships exist. They have to know that they're available. And by the way, this extends beyond just the recruiting team. As much as possible, you want everyone in your organization to be aware of these things. And we'll talk more about that in a second. So they need to be aware of what scholarships you have available, what you've created. They need to understand them. They need to know, exactly who are we targeting? What is the point of the scholarship? What is the message? And you need what salespeople call an elevator pitch. What's kind of the quick 20-second explanation of what the scholarship is, who it's for, how much money is on the line, how many recipients there will be, how to become eligible, how to apply, what's required. Your team needs to know all of those things, and they need to be able to communicate. They need to practice. They need to have talking points. If you can establish all those things, you're going to be able to kind of ensure maximum return on investment because you're going to be utilizing your scholarships at every turn. Every opportunity that exists to leverage your scholarships, you'll be able to put it in front of that right audience. Now, who is the right audience? Because you want to communicate to not just the students. Obviously, the students are key. Students are the ones who are not only receiving the scholarships, they're probably the ones who are most likely to talk about the scholarships with their fellow students and kind of spread that viral word of mouth. Obviously, students are the most important, so you want to have that elevator pitch down for how a student applies, where they need to go, what's the URL, what is the apply process like, how long is it going to take, how much money, again, is on the line. But don't forget, you also need to be able to communicate with faculty, and the pitch might be a little bit different to faculty, even if it's just as simple as saying, your student needs to do X, as opposed to referring to them in the second person and saying, you need to do so-and-so in order to apply. But you need to be able to speak to faculty about it because you want faculty to be able to become a co-promoter. You want faculty to buy in and invest their energy in promoting your scholarships. And of course, the same goes for career services, financial aid offices, organizations like that. They're going to spread the word as well. Career services especially, that's what they exist to do. Be ready. Put together, whether it's paper collateral, a PDF file, again, a little bit of an elevator pitch, a written speech, a spiel, if you will. Put something together for career services to make it easier for career services to share your scholarship with the students at their school. And don't forget about your colleagues. I mentioned it before that you want to have all the recruiting people, especially if you have a college recruiting team, you want to have all of them on the same page, in lockstep, saying the same things, using the same talking points. But especially if you're in a big company, but this is also important if you're in a small company, but especially if you're in a big company, you want to talk to all of your colleagues about it. You want to make sure that that person you run into in the lunchroom who works in another department on the other side of campus. Or maybe you're at a smaller company and it's the receptionist that you see every day, but you don't usually have to interact with and work with on a day-to-day basis. You need to be able to talk to your colleagues about it as well. Put together simple communication that you can share with those colleagues and reinforce it. And this is what we call internal selling. Sell your colleagues on the idea that they should be thinking of these scholarships anytime they meet a college student, anytime they have a friend or the child of a friend or their own children, anytime they run into anybody who might be of interest, that they can help spread the word. So you want to educate your colleagues as well, and last but not least, the general public. The reason they call it an elevator pitch is because you never know who you're going to run into in an elevator. If you run into a student who happens to have that perfect background, who happens to be exactly the person that you want to hire, but you're in the elevator at Macy's in the mall, you need to have that 20-second spiel to explain to them, hey, my company is doing a scholarship. You should really apply. That brings that student into the funnel. That helps get the word out. That is the power of the socialization aspect of scholarship. And this is why social media works online. This is just the offline version of it. Make sure that you're spreading the word.
Great. Thanks, Matt. So let's get down to actually how you actually create a scholarship program. Some of you may already have scholarships going. Some of you may not. So the first thing you need for creating a scholarship program is to have a champion within the company or your organization who's going to be the head and the administrator of this whole scholarship program or this entire scholarship program. Typically, at larger companies, we've seen the head of corporate philanthropy be the one who's managing the scholarships. If you have a head of corporate philanthropy, that's a great person to put this under. If you don't have somebody with such a role within your organization, somebody within the marketing program at your company is the best person to handle this. And if you have the bandwidth as somebody in the university recruiting team, if you can manage the scholarships, then this can definitely fall within the university recruiting function. So again, it's either corporate philanthropy, the marketing organization, or the university relations group where you can have somebody in charge of the scholarship. So once you know who's going to head it up, you need to allocate budget for it. And you should definitely see this as a 3 to 4 year investment. You can't do a scholarship for a year and expect results a year later. And we'll go into why a little bit later. But in a nutshell, if you're targeting, let's say, underclassmen, freshmen, sophomores, or even high school students, you're going to have to see the process through for at least 2 or 3 years until you can start seeing good long-term ROI. So a year is not going to be enough for you to gauge the effectiveness of scholarships.
And let me interject real briefly, Roberto, because I tell this to clients all the time, all of our partners that we work with, when they're first joining and they first start running maybe campaigns to target an audience. Certainly, we want to target the right audience, you want to get the message out, and you want to see immediate results. But if you're doing it right, you're starting early, you're starting with freshmen, or even students who haven't entered college yet. It's going to take 4 years before you reach that peak, before you really have reached critical mass, as they call it. So, you know, you should see an increase year over year, sort of a snowball effect happening, as more and more students are getting involved, are hearing about your scholarships, are hearing about whatever it is you're promoting on a college level, and sort of the word of mouth is spreading. The number of students who have maybe opted in to receive your emails or your messaging about your scholarships starts to increase. But it's that four-year mark when you know that you've really had 4 years to engage every student at every different level, and you know that you've maximized your results. So you need to be thinking of it in terms of 4 years at a minimum.
And in terms of the amount, so the amount could be as small as a $500 scholarship. You might do four $500 scholarships a year, or you can do $50,000 scholarships. It's, again, what you can support within your organization. But again, you could start small, and you should start small. I'll give you an example. So Amazon started a scholarship program earlier this summer, and they allocated $250,000 for 50 $5,000 scholarships. So you may be thinking, wow, I don't know if I can set aside $250,000 a year or $1 million for over 4 years for this. The point I want to make here is that this is $250,000, but again, it's a company that has about $75 billion in annual revenues. So for them, it's a drop in the bucket. However, that amount of money still makes an impact on students' lives, and it's newsworthy. So again, the point I want to make is no amount is too small. Students need help, and they welcome your financial support. Going on to the next slide. So once you figure out what your budget is, then the next step is, how do I start promoting the scholarships? And before you can actually start promoting the scholarships, you need to figure out, what's my target audience? Are you going to be targeting freshmen, sophomores? Are you going to be targeting high school students? And we'll get into criteria a little bit on a little bit in the next few slides. But once you figure out if you're going to be targeting underclassmen or high school students, students from a specific discipline, then here are some things you can do to start getting the word out immediately. And these are very effective channels for promoting your scholarship. So first of all, and the most obvious channel is the financial aid office, or the financial aid offices at the universities that you're targeting. So you could do a blanket approach where you can send your scholarship out to all the financial aid offices in your network of schools, whether it's nationwide or a certain area. The other thing you can do is, if you decide, hey, I'm targeting specific majors or specific disciplines, then faculty and student groups are very effective channels for getting the word out about these scholarships.
Especially because so many of those student groups are diversity focused as well. That's another way to layer in your targeting in the way that you promote your scholarships.
Exactly. So faculty are almost always happy to spread the word about scholarships to their students, and the same with student groups. So definitely leverage these channels. And then also figure out where students are. If you're targeting high school students, try to figure out where they go. Maybe they're looking for a college to go to, and you might want to advertise some services that promote scholarship applications or applying to college. Again, there's various channels, but these are some of the most effective ones, the ones we're listing here. And then last but not least, and this is actually very important, so by looking at the list of attendees we have this morning, I'm going to make a big assumption that the majority of you have a PR group within your organization, or you have PR agencies that you work with. So one thing is getting the scholarship in place, promoting it through these channels, but the other thing is definitely you need to leverage the PR group within your organization, right? So have them craft a press release. Have them leverage their media channels. In the Amazon example, a few slides back, you saw the announcement was made, and then tech publications like TechCrunch published or basically publicized the scholarship. And that's an example of the company using their PR group to get the word out. And again, getting the word out to very targeted publications that are most likely being read by the target student audience that this company is trying to reach, right? For example, computer science, engineering type students. So definitely leverage your PR resources and internal marketing resources, because you can't do it all on your own, and there's already processes in place, and you should definitely go across across the organization to get support for this. So you have your scholarship, you're promoting it, you figured out your target audience. Now comes the fun stuff, right? Now you got to start collecting applicants, and you got to start sifting through those applications, and you got to select the winners of your scholarship program. And this could seem like a daunting task. Some organizations do it in-house, and Matt will go over how a lot of these organizations do it internally. But some of the organizations we're working with, they'll promote the scholarship, and they'll drive interested students and applicants to their website, but they actually outsource the logistics of it to outside companies. There's actually outside providers that manage the application process, the selection process, and all the back end, right? And companies do this for two reasons. Number one, just to save time so they don't have to do it internally. Secondly, and most importantly, they want to keep the process impartial. So that's why they're using outside companies. And in the case of SanDisk, which is a top employer here in Silicon Valley, they're using a company called ISTS, International Scholarship and Tuition Services. We have no relation to this company, but we've just noticed that SanDisk and Amazon are both using this company to collect the applications. And in terms of how you actually determine amounts, and I'll pass it on to Matt, and you can get into more specifics about how you choose what amount to start out with.
Yeah, because I think, you know, what Amazon does, what SanDisk does, you know, SanDisk is a company that has $1 million of revenue per employee. Again, we looked at the attendee list. There's some great names and some huge companies, but there are also some great smaller companies that don't have that type of budget. Let's be realistic. Not all budgets are created equal. And we have to keep that in consideration when we figure out how we're going to fund a scholarship. You might be competing for talent with companies who can outspend you 100-1. There's candidates who are likely to apply for any and every scholarship for which they qualify, regardless of the amount. And so that's great that you don't necessarily have to worry about it being a big scholarship to get an applicant. But just getting the applicant is not the goal. Remember, the goal is to strengthen your brand. So it might not be a good use of a limited budget to try to match your competitor's every move. Instead, you want to be strategic. But finding audiences where a smaller investment will go a longer way. Again, targeting a diversity audience is another great example. We're going to talk more about diversity on the very next slide, actually. But targeting a small, diverse audience is sometimes a better way to kind of spread a small budget a little more thinly across and make a little bit bigger impact. If your competition is not offering a scholarship to one of your key candidate demographics, regardless of how small it is, that's a great opportunity for you to come in, be opportunistic, take advantage of that. If you have several competitors who are offering scholarships to your desired audience, make sure your budget actually allows for you to be competitive. A small scholarship is better than no scholarship, except when your scholarship is so small in comparison to your competitors that it actually makes you look bad. The technical term for it, I think, is rinky-dink. You don't want to appear to be that small, and appear that you can't compete. Sometimes the only way to win is not to play. And so that's okay, but don't, rather than bowing out altogether because you don't have a big budget, find the places where the small budget's going to make a big impact. Let me throw out a hypothetical example. Say there's three companies in the social media space here in Silicon Valley, and each of them is offering computer science majors from Stanford $20,000 scholarships. Now, is it wise for you to join the fray if your budget for a scholarship is $500? It makes you look small in relation to your competitors. It makes your competitors look bigger and better. You're actually helping them and hurting yourself. But if you can find an audience that is a little bit more targeted, a little bit smaller, that maybe there's not quite so much competition, I'll use again the example of women in engineering, you can run a scholarship that targets an audience no one else is going after, and then the amount of money becomes immaterial. Then you don't have to make sure that you're spending as much as your competitors. Just being there makes you the winner automatically. Or maybe there's only a handful of people competing for that audience and the amounts are smaller. Whatever it may be, you can be strategic. So when your budget doesn't allow you to just go in there and throw money around, it's really, I think, about honing in on small audiences where there's an opportunity, and not just saying, I only want these, Stanford computer science majors. Those people, that may not be, no matter how badly you want those candidates, scholarships may not be a great way for you to reach them. That's all. So I said I wanted to address diversity a little bit more. Diversity is obviously, everyone on the phone probably has corporate diversity and inclusion goals. Think about what your university recruitment diversity goals are. Are there certain schools you could target to help you reach those goals? Are there certain high schools or certain student groups that could help you reach those goals? Perhaps you're trying to find more African-American engineers, and you should be working with NSBE and maybe running a scholarship in conjunction with the National Society of Black Engineers. Or maybe you should be targeting students in a CS major at a historically black college or university. Building that target diverse audience, as you kind of determine who the audience is going to be for your scholarship and what the eligibility requirements are going to be, which is what we're going to talk about next, this is going to allow you, again, like we talked about on the last slide, to make sure that you're being opportunistic and you're being strategic about how you spend your money, but it's also going to allow you to kind of kill two birds with one stone and make sure that you're achieving the branding goals that your scholarship program was intended to achieve, and you're also attempting, at least, to achieve some of the D&I, the diversity and inclusion goals that your company has set out for recruiting and university recruiting specifically. Again, elite recruiters, they're going to start as early as high school offering scholarships for specific majors to diverse candidates who may or may not have thought about pursuing that type of degree. The example I always think of, I think it was a NetApp that does global scholarship offerings that are specifically targeting students who are in high school, some as early as middle school, trying to get women and other underserved minorities into STEM, into science, technology, engineering, and math. Going to what are developing countries where women are just now entering the workforce and convincing, adolescent kids and 13-year-old girls that, yes, you can become a computer engineer, and we're going to offer you a scholarship to do it. Super empowering, again, presents a really good image, which helps with your social consciousness goals, which helps with your connection to that global community. It also helps you achieve your diversity goals. It also may help you fill some of your key roles down the road. And last but not least, it helps solve a problem that the planet as a whole is facing, which is there is going to be a major gap, in the number of STEM workers that we have compared to the number of STEM jobs that we have open. We don't have enough people entering tech careers to fulfill the need, that sort of pent-up demand that's coming down the pike. So, you're doing something really great for the world if you can convince more people who would not have thought of it otherwise to go into a STEM career. That's just an example for if you're in the tech business. There's applicable examples for every industry. So again, think of a scholarship as an opportunity to achieve your diversity goals as well as your branding goals. Now, we talked about getting to eligibility. I want to kind of hammer home the importance of determining your eligibility up front, getting clear sets of guidelines, and alignment. Make sure that this aligns with what you're trying to achieve as an organization. Diversity is just one example of that. I'll give you a better example. We work with federal government organizations here in the United States that are not allowed to hire non-U.S. citizens. So would it make sense for them to give scholarships to folks who are not U.S. citizens? Of course not. So they should build that into their eligibility requirements. International students are not going to be eligible for those scholarships. Students who are in certain states may be the targets. Certain majors. Maybe you only want to include allow students from your specific top tier target schools to be eligible. That's okay. You can create a custom scholarship, whether it's something you do completely on your own grassroots, something you work with an organization like ISTS or After College to create, you can build a custom scholarship that is honed to exactly your audience and your need. Again, think about, is there a diversity component? Are you going to include high school students or college students only, or vice versa? Other thing that I think it's easy to forget, is financial need going to be a factor? Do you want to give scholarships to folks who have a demonstrated need only? Are you going to give scholarships to folks who maybe haven't necessarily proven that they need the money? And of course, are you going to use an essay? If there is an essay, what do you want to capture in that essay? How will you use it in the selection process? You're kind of resigning yourself when you make it an essay-heavy selection process to the fact that, in all likelihood, the winner is probably going to be someone with a strong liberal arts background or a strong writing background or a strong literature background. That may not make the most sense if you're looking for people with more of a stronger math skills, for instance. So you have to take all that into consideration up front. And then the natural kind of extension of that is building your selection committee. Who is going to handle candidate selection? Now, again, if you hire one of these outsourced to one of these other groups, they can handle the selection. They can handle the selection, but allow you to have a voice. Sometimes we work with clients who want us to handle the selection for the winner of the scholarship or who we award the scholarship to, but they still want to have some voice at the end. Let me see the top five, the five finalists, and help vote for who the winner is. That's okay as well. You can build all that sort of stuff in. If you're running it on your own, though, a couple things I want you to think of. This is a great opportunity to include your executive team. A lot of times, executives really enjoy being part of a selection committee, especially if it's a little later on in the process. Your SVPs probably don't want to read 300 one-page essays, but a lot of executives really appreciate being included in the final say on who received the scholarship. It can be a really great way to engage senior leadership and get them to support the university relations program and showcase your efforts. And not just for political reasons, but just to also ensure the visibility of the important work that you do to make sure that you get the budget next year. Now you have to figure out, who you want to apply, you know what they're going to apply to, your university team, recruiting team's all on board to spread the word. How else do you market your scholarships to ensure you get the most quality applicants? Well, this slide might look familiar. Scholarships, again, they're about reinforcing your brand to eventually attract the top talent your company needs. So a lot of companies work closely with their agencies and their marketing departments to have this comprehensive, consistent outreach policy to students in their talent pipeline. That's just marketing 101 nowadays. Scholarships should be no different. When marketing and messaging your scholarships, it should fit in with your corporate brand in a way that's relevant, in a way that's memorable to the entry-level talent you're trying to attract. You should continue to engage and educate students on your company's brand, on your culture, and eventually the opportunities. And you should start with the brand you want them to remember when marketing your scholarships. And then, from running scholarships here at After College and speaking with university recruiting professionals who've managed scholarship programs for years, I can tell you the importance of your communication schedule can't be underestimated. You've got to work backwards. You have to figure out, when do you want to have the scholarship recipient selected? How do you time it to get the most attention for your brand? How long will it take to do the selection? And therefore, when will the application deadline fall? If you're working back from the application deadline, when do you need to start marketing the program? How are you going to market it? We'll talk about that a little bit more in a moment, but we want to put all of your communication channels onto the schedule. So you can't forget, when and how are you going to give out the award? How are you going to publicize the winners? Put that on the schedule. Remember, students are deadline driven. That's a nice way to say that, students tend to procrastinate. I know I certainly did in college. You wait until the last minute. So bank on the fact that you're going to get most of your traffic and most of your applicants right at the deadline. So you want to create that plan, work the plan, and make sure everyone is on the same page about the plan and the time frame. As long as you work backwards from your deadline, you're going to be fine. All right, so you did all this work. How do you make sure it doesn't go to waste? This is not Field of Dreams. You don't just build it and expect them to come. You need to inform your target applicants that the scholarships are available. You need to tell them when and where and what to expect. So, you know, again, this is a branding opportunity for you. I hate to sound like a broken record, but you know, you need to work with your agency or your marketing department on the messaging. Figure out who and how to involve, who to involve and how to involve them in creating the right messaging for your scholarship and getting the word out. Whether that's your social media policy and including them in what you do from a social media perspective. The other thing, you know, do you have a database of past students you've spoken to previously? Hopefully you do. Leverage that. Make sure that you're communicating with that audience and reminding them about these scholarships, and they're helping get the word out. Do you have students who've applied for past scholarships or internships? Do you have a consumer-facing brand where you can kind of let their followers or customers know? You know, it's really great if you're, you know, part of a soft drink company or a cell phone company that has, you know, 20 million followers on Twitter. You can go ahead and ask them, you know, kind of tap them on the shoulder and say, hey, can you go ahead and promote the scholarship for me? That's great access. And once you have your messaging and your scholarship details, you want to get it out in every possible way that you can. You want to leverage, you know, student groups in universities. You know, you want to, see if those student groups have connections that can inform their, where they can inform their members. If you know somebody at Nesby or SWE, out in science, or an honor society, for instance, get that person involved and have them share. Ask the national organizations you engage with to let their student members know. Do you have alumni on staff who can help? You know, do they still have connections with their campus organizations? Can they contact faculty in key programs to ask them to let their students know? Get creative. Do you have a student ambassador program? That's another key thing. If you have student ambassadors, do they know about the scholarship details and deadlines? Student ambassador programs could actually be an entirely separate webinar. You know, and if there's interest, we could tackle that topic. We could tackle another topic coming up in a second about search engine optimization. We could take an hour on each of those. But you know, those are places where you can leverage those relationships to get the word out. And then, like I said before, financial aid offices. Now, here's a buzzword everybody knows, social media. Get the word out even more. Leverage, you know, Twitter. Get out there and tweet. Leverage Facebook. Leverage LinkedIn. Some media, social media especially is a form of advertising that takes time to build up. So, again, if you have a consumer-facing brand, leverage it. If you can, use search engine optimization. You know, I've done Google searches on careers and scholarships. You'd be surprised which big brands and big names don't come up at all. Some really small nonprofits have better optimized Google results than the big names. So you might need to talk to IT or marketing or your web development team and find out who's in charge of SEO for your site. See where you land, see where your competitors land, run a variety of Google searches. Don't run them from your perspective. Don't type your company's name. Run them from a student's perspective. Say, you know, I'm a computer science student looking for scholarships. How would I search Google and see if you show up there? Students find most of their information through search engines, so don't downplay the strategy. This is super, super important. And again, SEO could be a whole other topic. If you have questions, we'll try to answer them today, or we can take them offline. Feel free to email me directly. We'll have all the contact info available at the end of the presentation. And then this is something that's key from all engagements that you have with students, whether it's career fairs, internships, scholarships. Remember the top students, the ones who impress you, the ones that you engage with, that really, where you feel that connection, where you feel like you can see them making an impact. Earmark them, put them in a special file, you know, create a dossier, whatever system you want to have in place. Keep those folks top of mind and follow up with them more aggressively. Stay on top of them.
So coming to the topic of ROI, I mean, this is one of the most important hurdles in getting a scholarship program started at your organization. So the question is, all right, we're going to allocate X amount of money for scholarships. What are we going to get out of it? Again, as we mentioned earlier, this is a four-year investment, right? So if you started off, you can't really see the full impact of the scholarships until 4 years after you started. However, you know, we know that's not good enough. You've gotten budget for this and you need to justify it. So here's the quick sort of back of the envelope calculation you can make to justify the ROI. It's very simple, extremely simple. So you take the amount of money you're budgeting for scholarships, And what you do is then you then divide by the number of applicants you're getting. So let's say you're budgeting 20,000 applicants or $20,000 for your scholarships, and you're getting 40,000 applicants, right? Your cost per applicant there is 50 cents. And let's say you're targeting STEM majors or healthcare majors. Those individuals are very hard to reach. And if you're reaching them, even as applicants, and even if they're not getting the scholarship, or let's say they're not yet applying to your jobs, because again, they could be sophomores, they could not be, maybe they're interested yet in looking for internships. But again, that simple calculation is going to give you a good measure of effectiveness, and that's a very short-term metric you can use right now.
And remember too, you're getting, we're talking about hitting that audience one time with a scholarship and engaging them one time for 50 cents each. But now you have their names and email addresses. You get to re-engage with that audience time and time and time again. You'd be foolish not to. You know, it makes so much sense to create some sort of talent network or student network and keep a list of these names and email addresses so that you can engage with them with great frequency going forward on all sorts of different topics, because every time you hit them, again, they're free, and you're just increasing your ROI from this initial touch point.
Hey, I see a question. So Amy's asking, if we have a suggested list of third-party administrators, right? So I'm going to jump in and answer that question right now because I know it's been on there for a while. So the example I mentioned with Amazon and SanDisk is ISTS. It stands for International Scholarship and Tuition Services. And one thing you should, and we haven't worked with them, but we know that Amazon's using them. We know SanDisk is using them. I'm a big fan of SanDisk, so if they're using them, I'm assuming they're good. We, after college, we actually partner with nonprofits. We do our own scholarships. One of them is this big nursing scholarship, and we're actually partnering with a nonprofit, the American Association of Colleges of Nursing, and we actually give them the funds, and they're the ones that are doing all the logistics, right? So you can partner not just with third-party vendors, but you can actually reach out to the nonprofits and see if they're willing to administer the scholarship for you and sort of do a joint scholarship with you. And this could be an organization like SHEP, NSBE, Nishimba. You're going to have to go and see which organizations are the ones that are willing to do this. Hopefully that answers the question.
We have one other question we might as well hit up while we're here, too. It was asked, is it legal to restrict eligibility to students from specific schools? For instance, if we want to allow one scholarship for each of five target universities. And to best of my understanding, there's no reason why you can't do that. There's plenty of scholarships that you can do in partnership or in conjunction with those schools, where obviously only students at those schools would be eligible. But I don't think there's anything stopping you from independently running a scholarship where only students from a certain school are eligible. There's tax laws and some other legal things that are tied into scholarships that we can't give legal advice on. So, you know, technically speaking, definitely still talk to your legal team. We're not lawyers here, but I've seen it done. I have no reason to believe that you can't pick and choose on that level.
And adding to what Matt said, we're not lawyers. We do have lawyers though, and for our scholarships, we've actually had our legal counsel create the terms of service in the scholarship rules. So definitely, once you create your requirement list, have your legal folks go through that wording and make sure it's good to go.
So we just got a few more slides left, and then we'll tackle any other questions that may be thrown our way. Because now it's actually time for the fun part, awarding the recipients. You know, I won't show the video to you right now because we don't have a ton of time, but if you go out on YouTube, you can actually run a search for the Geico Gecko coming into a classroom and presenting a recipient with one of those big checks for her scholarship that she received. There's a lot of fun ways to make awarding the scholarship and giving the money a big deal. And I've never personally received one, but man, getting a big check is a lot of fun. It probably seems a little played out, but I don't think there's anything wrong with printing out a giant check, getting a lot of pictures of it, throwing those pictures around, putting them on your website, sending them out in emails, showing that happy student receiving that money. Leverage the good vibes, leverage that positive impact that money has on people. You're helping kids pay for school. That is huge. Use this opportunity. This is another great opportunity to strengthen your brand on campus. It's going to sound kind of corny, but make it into a party. You know, scholarship programs are a large investment, especially if you're going to do them in-house. You're not just investing money, but you're investing a lot of effort, a lot of man hours. It's a ton of work. Make granting the awards fun. Have a party. You know, whether it's virtual or an in-person party, spread the word. Celebrate. You know, get out there and internally in your company as well. Use the award winners to spread goodwill. But you know, internally or externally, reinforce the campus presence externally. You know, these folks who are receiving the money, they are, in a sense, mini ambassadors for you now. Encourage them, help them share the word. And, you know, I got a brand new slide for you. You've never seen this one before. Check it out. brand. Use it to establish your brand. I mean, this is really what I want you to remember. Studies show you're not going to remember more than three things. Remember? We talked about that before. Remember how important it is to use scholarships to leverage your brand. You know, people love to celebrate the success of others. You know, the winners' friends and families, their university connections, they're all going to want to celebrate. And the company who awarded them with the scholarship gets to be center stage. Take that opportunity to let them shine. You know, reinforce your brand at the same time. Throw a party. You know, like I said, get faculty permission, but show up in the classroom dressed as a gecko. Whatever is going to make the big impact and make you memorable and top of mind. So, you know, as we wrap up here, the last few things I want to kind of go over. We talked several times about how scholarships are an integral piece of your broader university recruitment strategy. So for just that reason, the best of the best, they integrate their scholarships directly into their college recruitment website. One example here I want to draw your attention to. This is a student center on Xerox's career website. The scholarship applicants, it allows you to kind of reinforce your new grad applicants and your commitment to giving back and connect the two in a meaningful way. Oh, you're looking for a scholarship? Here are career opportunities. Oh, you're interested in our career opportunities? Here are our scholarships. You know, keeping the two really closely tied together, it's very encouraging to people who are applying to jobs to know that you have a little money to throw around for philanthropic purposes and that you care enough to share it with students. And it's really encouraging for students who are applying for scholarships to see that you have great job opportunities that might be a fit for them. That's your employment brand hitting home. Microsoft, another cool example here. They have kind of, you might hear it called a micro site for college recruiting. There's nothing really micro about it. Microsoft's site for college recruiting is huge. They have something like 50 college recruiters, for all these individual regions. They have more college recruiters than a lot of companies have employees. But they really do a great job, and this is something that even small companies can do. They really do a great job of incorporating scholarship into the career and internship pages. So, you know, check out their site. You'll find they have a really substantial presence for students that demonstrates their commitment to the young talent as the future of the company. I could rattle off a dozen more examples. I really love Intel's student site. Intel has a really great student site where they talk about their scholarships. Geico. Geico incorporates a lot of video and uses social media. You can kind of see on this page the different specs Geico has chosen for their particular program, where they talk about the focus on the years in school and the types of majors they want to attract. They really get into the program, but they show video of somebody receiving the check. It connects the dots. It goes, brings it all full circle. And last but not least, Kaiser Permanente. Really probably one of the biggest healthcare players out here on the West Coast, but they don't really have the same presence in the Midwest and on the East Coast. So for them, employment brand is really vital because they're trying to recruit and hire doctors and nurses and allied health folks from all over the country when only people on the West Coast have ever used Kaiser as their insurance/healthcare provider. So go to their site and watch the video if you have a chance. It's really done well. It represents kind of the impact on the world that the scholarships they present will make. And they're also, the scholarships specifically are a great example of that kind of community aspect that we talked about. So check out Kaiser's site. Again, if you have questions or you want to see anything in particular, you want to reach out to us for specific links, let us know. We'd be happy to share that stuff. I think pretty much wraps up, but I want to touch on that we do have, this is a continuing, this is an ongoing series of webinars, our university recruiting series. Interns in your campus brand is the next topic we're going to cover on November 19th. You can always go to webinars.aftercollege.com to see the latest webinars that we have going on. Obviously, you're welcome to attend. They're all free, and also watch your email. Invitations might be coming via email, and you can easily pass those on to others that you think might benefit. If you have an idea or you want to request a future topic, feel free to let us know. But with that, I want to open the floor up to any remaining questions that we may have. Looks like, did we cover all the questions? I think we did. Oh, you know, I do have a couple. I want to see if I can touch on a couple of these. One of the questions is, how do you present ROI to company management? Do you have examples? Roberto kind of touched on that briefly about the you know, doing the math. One of the things that I would recommend from a recruitment technology perspective, leveraging, if you have an applicant tracking system and it's tied into your student career network, your talent network, as I like to call it, that's going to make you a superstar when it comes to demonstrating ROI. This is kind of what sales and marketing people are doing a lot of marketing automation now, inbound marketing as they call it, and this is sort of a similar version of that, content marketing. These are kind of the buzzwords that you hear in the sales and marketing world. This is a similar version of that in terms of recruiting. As soon as you have a person's name and email address, they may not be a candidate yet. They may not have given you a resume yet, but they are a lead. And so from a salesperson's perspective, a lead is a great start. That's somebody you can contact. That's somebody you can check out on social media. You can find out if they're a good fit, and you can follow up with them. But the best thing about a lead is now you can email them, you can contact them, you can reconnect with them over and over and over again. So as long as you have that tracking in place and you can track every email that you send and every interaction that you have after that, it's very, very easy for you to demonstrate the ROI, not just in the short term and not just, oh, this one email campaign or this one scholarship or this one career event generated X ROI. You can actually show your return on investment over the span of that 2, 3, 4 year period. You can show how, look, we connected with this student when they were in high school, and we convinced her to check out a webinar that we were doing about women in tech. And next thing you know, she decided to become a computer science major at Stanford. And next thing you know, she graduated with a CS or an EE degree, and she applied to come work here. And she was an intern here, and now she's our employee. If you can track that entire path for even a small number of candidates, that's going to blow people away. This is the sort of thing that really you want. This is Valhalla. This is the ultimate success. If you can have this, you're way ahead of the game. So that's one of my suggestions for tracking ROI, is to get a talent network in place where you can track these people even if they haven't applied for a job or an internship yet.
One more question. Okay. So what is the minimum dollar amount you suggest for a scholarship that requires a short essay? So I would say the minimum amount for the scholarship should be $500. You shouldn't go below that. And if it requires an essay, I would just say keep the essay as short as possible if you even need one. You may not need a long essay. Maybe you just need a statement of purpose or something. But just keep in mind, the students will apply for scholarships, but if the sort of cost-benefit ratio is such where $500 might be not enough and have to write a long essay, you might miss people. So yeah, be mindful of that. Another question that's related is, do we need to adjust the scholarship amount based on the tuition charged at the specific campus? That's actually a really good question. I don't know if I have a clear answer for that, but I don't think it matters, because you might have a campus with high tuition, but at the same time, maybe the students you're trying to target receive financial aid, right? So you don't necessarily, I don't think you have to target it by campus. I think more by demographic across campus, but I don't think the scholarship amount makes a big difference at campuses. At least we haven't seen a difference.
Hey, we got a few other great questions, but unfortunately we are out of time. What I'd like to do, I think Trish and Amy, we may have gotten all of your questions. If we haven't, we'll follow up with you. Trish will follow up with you as well. Anybody who didn't get their question answered, please don't hesitate to contact us directly. There's several ways that you can get in touch with us. Of course, obviously, like any company, we're on Twitter, at After College. We have our services for employers that you can check out at employer.aftercollege.com. You can see a little bit about how popular your company is on campus by going to aftercollege.com/popularity and check out our Employment Popularity Index. And then if you want to contact my sales team, talent@aftercollege.com. If you want to contact me directly, it's M as in Mary, B as in Boy, A as in Apple, U umbrella, M as in Mary, mbaum@aftercollege.com. And you can also contact Roberto or anybody on our team. Please just reach out to me if there's anything that I can provide. But again, thank you guys so much for attending and carving out an hour for us. Great questions, and we really appreciate the chance to present to you guys.
And we'll be sending out a survey after this, so definitely feel free to give us feedback on what you got out of this, what you want to hear about next. And again, thank you for your time. Have a good remainder of the week, and thank you for joining us.
Take care, everybody.